I want to go to Nick Underwood, who flew through Hurricane Ian today as one of NOAA's hurricane hunters. Let me just show you part of the video that he posted.
Oh, there goes the signs. There goes the beds. Holy cow.
Nick is with me now. Nick, 76 flights, 6 years of storms. You say this was the worst of your career. I mean, it makes me terrified to even watch that. But the beds thrown to the ground, everything spilled. What was it like?
It was definitely the roughest flight that I've been on. As you said, that was my 76th hurricane penetration. So it's 76 times into a hurricane and back out the other side. And out of all of those, that was absolutely the worst. There was a ton of turbulence, both up and down, and the lateral turbulence, which is honestly the most unsettling part of it. It was something else.
So you, yesterday, when we show your video you took yesterday when you went through the storm, compared to the video you went through today, you actually experienced a storm that literally was moving, had strong winds, but then just floored it. Right? What happened in that 24 hours?
So our flight yesterday, the storm was coming off of the coast of Cuba, and so it was getting into that warm water in the Gulf of Mexico, and it really started to ramp up. And just this morning on our flight, as we were flying through, it was intensifying up to that strong high-end Category 4, and really just had all the right conditions in place. The warm water beneath, not a ton of wind shear. And that's what allows these storms to really grow in size and intensity.
So when you talk about going through 76 storms, and you're talking about how disturbing it was today, not just the up and down turbulence, but the lateral turbulence, which you say that's much more disturbing. I think everyone can instinctually understand why, although no one can probably imagine tolerating the turbulence that you do. Absolutely horrifying. But what is it that makes this storm different? We've been trying to understand why it is so unprecedented, why it is so strong. From your experiential point of view, what's the answer?
76 flights through 22 different storms. Every single storm is different. This particular one, the things that really stood out to me was that intense turbulence, especially on the western side, which normally is not the strongest part of the storm. Another thing that really stood out was the amount of lightning. So I shared some other photos. We were flying through at night, but once we got into the eye, I was taking photos like it was daytime because there was just so much lightning outside. And like I said, it's really just those simple factors that really contribute to these storms growing in size, that ocean temperature, the low wind shear, those kind of things.
Your tolerance for this is obviously high. This is what you do for a living, which again, most people can't imagine, but you're saying that today was different than anything else you've been in. At any point, were you actually worried about yourself and being in danger?
There's that moment where you're a little worried just because things are bouncing around and, moving around you. But then you remember the crew that you're with. The pilots up front are absolutely experienced, the flight engineers with them, the flight directors, meteorologists on board. You think about the ground maintainers who were taking care of the aircraft before we even got in the air. All of these people are fantastic, the absolute best in the business. And you remember how good and how dedicated to their jobs they are. And any kind of worry you have that we're not going to make it out of there kind of melts away.
You talked about some of the images and pictures you took of the lightning, and we showed some of those, but was that also different, just the fierceness and the intensity of the lightning?
It was certainly really not something that I had seen before. The closest that I had seen prior to that was Laura in 2020. We did a mission when it was over Hispaniola. That was the most lightning I had seen around a tropical cyclone prior, but until this morning, flying around in Ian, sure.
Wow. All right, thank you very much. Glad you're back and on the ground. But it is the work. It is the work.
Here.
Yeah, it's the work that people like Nick and his crews do that enable all of us to understand what these storms are doing and where they're going. And those flights are what save lives and communities throughout the storm path. So thank you so much. Now I want to go to Punta Gorda. I know we were trying to get Bill Weir, and he is back. He's on the phone with me now. We've been able to establish communications with him again, though. Bill, obviously you are in the middle of it. I don't know if you just heard Nick, who's thrown through 76 of these storms, say this is the worst in many ways that he has ever experienced or seen. What are you seeing now?
absolutely the same. Yeah, the back end of this storm was much more violent, it felt like, from our post than the front end that we watched come in. But yes, these are not your father's or your grandfather's hurricanes. The oceans are warmer. The oceans are higher. These are engines for hurricanes, for big storms, steroids for these storms. And scientists, climate scientists have been warning about this for a very long time, that the warmer these oceans get, and they've absorbed 90% of the heat in those rivers. The size of atomic bombs, every second of every day is absorbed by the oceans. They've covered up a lot of the of humanity's sins when it comes to warming the planet. But now this is the result. You've got these storms that are just, it's the acceleration, right? What we had last night, it was going to be a Category 2 when we woke up, and then it had already been a Category 4. Same thing happened with the typhoon in the South China Sea last week that caught people by surprise. It went from a 1 to a 5 in 6 hours. And so that sort of thing is a new normal here. I'm in a place that is probably the best equipped to test adaptation to this new planet that we're living on and these new realities because of Hurricane Charlie 18 years ago. Blew through here, absolutely decimated this town. And they were the first in Florida to adapt a climate resiliency coastal plan that includes everything from building codes to buying up vulnerable flooded properties and making public spaces. So we will see what those measures did compared to maybe neighboring communities. That's all discussions for the future. Right now, I keep thinking about families hunkering down, maybe new Floridians with kids. The uncertainty in this darkness now, as I'm standing in total blackout in Punta Gorda, then that becomes days of heat, with no air conditioning, with no refrigeration, and then comes the mold, and then comes the fight with the insurance companies. So sadly, this is the beginning of a lot of misery.
A lot of misery.
And down here.
Bill, thank you very much. And as I said, Bill's right in the middle of this, so you could, even that cell phone communication was taking some hits. I do want to just say here, as we try to squeeze in a break, Bill just raised something really important that I haven't heard a lot of, and that is there are a lot of people who are in Florida right now who weren't in Florida a year or two ago, who haven't gone through a storm, never mind like this one, because no one has. And how does that change things? People who weren't prepared or may not have known how seriously to take these kinds of warnings. There's been a lot of people who've moved to Florida.